Today I'm going to talk about distributions. Distributions in 2018, that could sound strange to you, because clearly distributions are not hype anymore. I actually did a small experiment. I took the schedule for FOSDEM for two different editions of FOSDEM and looked at the dev rooms about distributions. And in 2007, there were four different dev rooms about distributions for total capacity of almost 400 seats. And all dev rooms were for the 2 days. This year, only one dev room, only one day, 80 seats. So I'm not sure if you are familiar with the concept of the hype cycle, which basically describes how we talk about technology and how we adopt technology. It can be summarized as the more you go to the left, you get technology that everybody is talking about it, but nobody is really using it yet. And on the right, you have technology that everybody is using it, nobody talking about it. That works for other things as well. So if you look at this graph, distributions are clearly currently more to the right. But still, it's probably a good time to look at all the work that was done on distributions and see what lessons we can learn from that and what can be transferred, for example, to language package managers. So let's look at successes and failures of distributions. So first, what are distributions? Distributions sit in the middle between upstream projects like the Linux kernel, GNOME, the GNU project, or HRproxy, and end users. And what distributions do is take software developed by the upstream projects and turn them into packages that are provided to end users. And they do that for a large variety of different upstream projects. If you look at those projects, HRproxy doesn't look like GNOME at all. And that brings me to the first success of distributions. It's the universal package format. Most important bits of free software are available as Debian packages today. That's thanks to a fairly complex toolchain that was developed over the years in the Debian way, which means that you have at the bottom layer, the most low-level tools, you have a first layer of abstraction called Debhelper. Then you have a first layer of abstraction for this layer of abstraction, which is called CDBS. And then someone came up with another solution, which is called DH. You have another layer for languages and tools to deal with complex workflows involving Git-based packaging or SVN. But this works very well in the end. It's not that hard to learn. And the important point here is that Debian managed to leverage the language package manager. So stuff like RubyGems, PyPy, CPAN, NPM, Akh, Pyr, and whatever. So that we can easily convert foreign packages, packages for using those systems, into Debian packages. And those tools are actually very much usable to build your own custom packages. So if you use the programming languages behind those tools, you can actually easily use those tools to convert your RubyGems packages, for example, into Debian packages. I'll come back to that later in my talk, but there are two pointers here to the page listing how to use all those tools and a tutorial about how to start packaging for Debian. The second success I want to talk about today is the consistent and fairly high quality we achieve in Debian and other distributions. Distributions are not just package repositories. There's a lot of work going on inside distributions about doing quality assurance, and we developed many tools and services to do that. For example, in the context of Debian, we have a tool called Lintian that is a static analyzer for packages that is able to detect all the common mistakes that package maintainers make. It also looks at the conformance to the Debian policy, which is a huge document describing what Debian packages should look like. We have another tool called Doze that analyzes the graph of dependencies between packages and tries to identify packages that cannot be installed anymore, for example. We have a tool called PewParts that checks whether the installation, upgrade, and removal processes work, making sure that the scripts that are executed during those processes still work. And we have various continuous integration solutions For example, one called CI Debian Net that runs CI tests over each package, leveraging the test suites that are provided by upstream when there are some. Or we have tools, so that's something I personally work on. We do archive rebuilds, that is, take every source package in Debian and check whether it still builds using the current state of Debian. So that's great to detect stuff like a new GCC version that becomes slightly stricter about some obscure detail of C or C++, and that breaks hundreds of packages. That's something that happens all the time in Debian. So the goal from the point of view of the distribution is to detect issues as early as possible automatically and to ensure the same level of quality for all packages. So in some way, you can see distributions as washing machines of the free software world. Usually, when something gets into a distribution, it gets washed up, and all licensing issues and build system issues or strange choices of build systems get removed from the software. And I think that's something that can really be learned from distributions and that should be transferred to a language package repository, because most of them are not quite there yet in terms of QA infrastructure around the repository. The third success I'd like to talk about is the fact that distributions are actually organized in an ecosystem of distributions. Earlier, I showed this figure about upstream projects and users, but actually the global picture is much more complex than that. Distributions like Debian have derivative distributions, like Tails or Ubuntu. And some derivative distributions even have their own derivative distributions. And there's only about a dozen first-level distributions at Debian that interact with upstreams for most of their packages. So let's talk about failures now. The first one is that there's something missing on this picture. So everything going downstreams work quite well, software flowing from upstream projects to distributions, to derivatives, etc. But what about going backward, going up? So the ideal picture should look like that. Users should be able to report feedback and bugs to distributions, and that feedback should flow back to the upstream projects. It's not that clear that it works very well. When we talk to upstream projects, most of them are not that happy with their interactions with distributions. There are several reasons for that. One of them is the unclear status of distributions' bug tracking systems. Are those for packaging issues? Are those for all issues about the software being packaged? The boundary between those is sometimes a bit blurry, and that results in user feedback getting lost, specifically for smaller distributions that clearly don't have the manpower to bring everything back to upstream projects. The other problem is a problem of duplication of information between bug trackers, upstream, and in distributions. We know that distributed bug tracking is very difficult. Actually, even a simpler problem than distributed bug tracking, that is tracking the state of issues over several branches, that's already difficult. So just to give you an idea, that's how we solve this problem in Debian. So in Debian, bugs are not just open or closed. They are actually known as fixed or found in every version of the package. So what the bug tracker does is it passes the changelog for each version of the package that was ever uploaded to Debian. So it's able to build that graph of versions. And then that graph is annotated to know in which versions the bug that was fixed. So that's a really nice way to be able to say that a given bug is found in the root version here and fixed in all the branch that we support. It's testing and unstable on one side, stable and all stable. Launchpad does some, also addresses the same issues in a different way. In Launchpad, a given bug can affect multiple packages. And for each branch of development of Ubuntu, for example, you can know whether the bug, you can know about the state of the bug. So you can annotate to say the fix is released in that specific branch, it won't be fixed in that specific branch, etc. So what we probably need in the end is some kind of federation of bug trackers to be able to avoid all that duplication of information and information loss. But that, as you all know, distributed systems and federations are difficult problems. But that's something that I hope some of you will go back home and start working on tonight. The second failure I will discuss today is that usually you don't get from distributions the software that you want. There's still lots of stuff that is not packaged in distributions, and there's lots of stuff that is not packaged in the right version, the version you need for your work. So as a result, your virtual machine or container image usually looks like that. At the bottom, you have the base system and the dependencies for your app, all the system libraries. And for that, usually, you use distribution packages. Then you have custom versions of distribution packages for some stuff, because maybe in Debian stable, that's not the version you need. Then there's your application that you deploy using Git or file copy or whatever other language-specific technology. And then there are dependencies for that application using usually language packages such as RubyGems or PyPy. And usually you have a lot of fragile code to glue all these things together. I'm not sure if you probably, most of you saw that XKCD from a few weeks ago. And the point was that containers are a nice way to glue together stuff that we don't fully understand. But going back to that, well, since I work on distributions, of course, I tend to see packages as the solutions to every problem in the world. And so, could we solve that by making use of distribution packages? And actually, I think that there are several good reasons to do that. It would make it possible to use the same mature tools for everything. For example, all the build tools, all the build toolchain, all the tools around building and testing packages, but also tools like package repository managers. There are many tools to build your own infrastructure, in-house infrastructure to deploy, to distribute Debian packages. And it's also a way to bridge the gap between ops and devs. By integrating application deployment into configuration management. And that's helpful even if you rely on containers, because it would help with improving your containers' build code, make it easier to maintain and more reproducible. So I will describe quickly two different solutions that can help towards that. The first one is actually based on the automatic packaging tools that I talked about earlier. Actually, what we could do is use a single big package, a single big Debian package for the top two layers. That is, glue together the application and the dependency into a single Debian package. So that's what tools like Bundler or virtualenv already do. And actually, you can just do the step further, turning that into a Debian package very easily. What does it look like? So let's take RubyGem as an example. If you do gem to deb foo, you get a basic Debian package that works for that RubyGem. So let's look at what's generated. The Debian rules file is the file that describes the workflow to build the package. So it's a makefile. It doesn't look like a makefile. It kind of looks like a makefile. It uses a lot of GNU make magic. But most of the magic stuff is moved to DH. So that actually works and builds most Ruby gems into Debian packages out of the box. But that's what would be used to build a standard Debian package. And if you want to add the bundle generated by Bundler, you can simply do something like that. You can just run bundle install -dash standalone during the build process. So I'm not going to go into details, but With DH, we use a system of overrides or inheritance so that you can override specific steps. And then you can just install that bundle into somewhere on the file system. And with that, you actually get a Debian package that includes your bundle. So no need to get to use separate Debian packages for all of your apps Ruby dependencies. Of course, you still need to hack the load path so that the app will look for libraries in the bundle. So that's also a way to achieve building your application once and then distributing it as a Debian package to all your machines. The second helper I'm going to talk about is AutoDebianNet. So that's a Google Summer of Code project from this summer that I'm currently mentoring. The goal of this project is to design a service that integrates all the tools that I talked about previously about doing QA to automatically build packages for everything that can be automatically built. So that means, for example, backports for Debian development branch. Debian has its backports, but many packages could be easily backported and aren't currently. New upstream versions, because sometimes upgrading a package to the new upstream version can be done automatically when the new upstream is fairly similar to the current version. Language package repositories such as RubyGems or PyPy, we could actually package automatically all RubyGems and all PyPy modules into Debian packages. Or custom versions of packages in like Ubuntu PPAs. And all of that could be done using all Debian QA checks to understand whether the package actually works. We are not going to achieve 100% success, of course, but probably something like 90% packages will just work out of the box. So that's work in progress. And I hope that we'll be able to play with that by the end of the summer. Thank you.